We want to write the system of equations as an augmented matrix and then solve the system by writing the matrix in reduced row echelon form. So the first thing we should recognize is that we have a system of two linear equations with two unknowns. So we'll have a 2x3 augmented matrix. And since both equations are in standard form, we can go ahead and write the augmented matrix where the first row will be 2, negative 4, 8. And the second row will be 1, negative 2, 4. Notice how the first column contains the coefficients of x, the second column contains the coefficients of y, and the third column contains the constants. And now we want to write this in reduced row echelon form, so let's go ahead and review the conditions that must be met in order to have a matrix in reduced row echelon form. Number one, the first non-zero element in each row, called the leading entry, is 1. 2, each leading entry or 1 is in a column to the right of the leading entry or 1 in the previous row. Number 3, rows with all zero elements, if any, are below rows having a non-zero element. If these first three conditions are met, we have row echelon form. The fourth condition is what makes reduced row echelon form. So number 4, in each column that contains a leading entry of 1, all other elements of the column are 0. And here are several examples of matrices in reduced row echelon form. If we focus on the main diagonals highlighted here in yellow, notice in many cases the main diagonal only contains 1, but if the main diagonal does contain a 0, the system would have either no solution or infinite solutions. Regardless of this, notice how when the first entry is positive 1, all their elements in that column are 0. The way we transform the matrix is by a process called Gaussian elimination, which means any two rows can be interchanged, the elements of any row can be multiplied by a non-zero real number, and number 3, any row can be changed by adding or subtracting the corresponding elements with another row. So going back to our system, let's start by obtaining a 0 in this position here. And since the corresponding element in row 1 is positive 2, notice how if this element here was negative 2, we could then add the two rows to obtain a 0. So our first row operation is going to be to replace row 2 with negative 2 times row 2 plus row 1. So the first row will stay the same. And now for the second row, we'll have negative 2 times 1 plus 2, that's 0. Negative 2 times negative 2, that's positive 4, plus negative 4, that's also 0. And then negative 2 times positive 4 is negative 8, plus positive 8 is 0. Notice how in this case we have an entire row of zeros, which indicates our system will have an infinite number of solutions. But before we talk more about this, this matrix is still not in reduced row echelon form because we need this first element here to be positive 1. So for the last step, we'll go ahead and replace row 1 with 1 half times row 1 so that we have reduced row echelon form. So the first row would now be 1 half times 2, that's 1. 1 half times negative 4, that's negative 2. And 1 half times 8 is positive 4. Second row is still 0, 0, 0. Now to understand why we have an infinite number of solutions, we're going to go ahead and write this back as a system of equations. So looking at the first row, this is telling us that 1x minus 2y equals 4, or x minus 2y equals 4. The second row is telling us 0x plus 0y equals 0, or 0 equals 0. So whenever we obtain an equation like this that does not contain variables, it's either always true or always false. If it's false, we have no solution. If it's true, we have an infinite number of solutions. And since 0 equals 0 is true, we have infinite solutions. Just because we have infinite solutions does not mean that any value of x and y would satisfy this system. The values of x and y share a special relationship, and we're often asked to express this relationship using parametric equations. What I mean by this is, if we take a look at this first equation here, x minus 2y equals 4, notice if we were to solve this for x, we would add 2y to both sides, and we would have x equals 2y plus 4. Notice how this equation expresses a relationship between x and y that would give us solutions for the system. If we select any value for y, we could perform substitution and find the corresponding x that satisfies this system. However, to have a separate equation for both x and y, we often introduce a new variable to express this relationship. For example, if we let our new variable be t, where t is any real number, notice how if we let y equal t, then x would have to be equal to 2t plus 4. These parametric equations express the relationship between x and y that would give us solutions for the system given any value of t that's a real number. And because this system has an infinite number of solutions, we can say it's consistent and dependent. To check this, we could graph the two linear equations on the same coordinate plane to see if they have an infinite number of points in common, which means if we graph these two lines on the same coordinate plane as we have here, they're actually the same line, which means they share an infinite number of points, indicating the system has an infinite number of solutions. I hope you found this explanation helpful.